Dear learners, in this session, we shall learn about deserts and desertification. Deserts are nothing but dry lands, and they have occupied large areas of our planet. And more than 2 billion people inhabit these areas. 41% of these deserts are the dry lands. And we shall also learn about the different adaptation that plants and animals have in these deserts. Why the deserts are occurring, the characteristics of the deserts, where the deserts are formed, the global distribution of the of these deserts, and certain anthropogenic or human factors which have resulted in more degradation of the lands, which are causing desertification, and this is a cause of concern. Coming to the objective, after reading this module or the unit, you should be able to understand and define the term deserts and desertification. Explain the different characteristics of deserts, explain the fluvial and wind processes that are occurring in deserts, describe the life forms, adaptations, and list some anthropogenic factors which are responsible for desertification. So, as I said, deserts have occupied large parts of the earth's surface, and they host endemic plants and animals which are specific to these desert regions. More than 41% of the earth's land surface is covered by dry lands, and they are inhabited by 2 billion people. 20% of the deserts is already degraded. More is under threat from desertification. So, desertification process affects about 1.9 billion hectares of land and 1.5 billion people worldwide. Let us see some definitions pertaining to deserts. Deserts are subtropical arid regions where potential evaporation is more than 2000 millimeters and the annual precipitation is about less than 200 millimeters. The desertification, the United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification has defined this as land degradation in arid, semi-arid and dry subhumid regions resulting from various factors including climatic variations and human activity. So, these are some definitions. The characteristics of deserts, as we all know, it is characterized by dry climate and the nature of the precipitation. The rate of the evaporation is more than the rate of precipitation. So, the rainfall or the amount of water received in a desert is less and the evaporation rates are fairly high. Causal factors of dryness, there is no vertical air movement and no air cooling, so no atmospheric condensation take place. There is high landscape potential, erosion potential. That is, there is a lack of vegetation and the sudden intense rainfall events can also erode this landscape over there. Weathering, mainly physical weathering is dominant here. Due to the lack of water, the chemical weathering is minimal. There is poor soil development. There is impermeable surface layers that are present here due to the bedrock and the salt beds and hard pans that are formed. Little infiltration and the surface runoff is possible. More surface runoff is possible and little infiltration occurs. That is, they are not getting into the layers. The drainage patterns, the deserts mainly have ephemeral streams that either flow seasonally or they can only flow during the storms. The type of deserts and global distribution. So, the deserts normally they can be distributed and classified as hot deserts. As the name indicates, these are situated near the equator, they are very hot. The day temperatures reach 38 degrees centigrade, they have very cold nights. The Great Sandy Desert of Australia is one example to cite. The cold deserts, these are found away from the equator in the center of the continents like in Argentina and Antarctica. The inland deserts, they are found far away from the sea. The coastal deserts are found by the sea, found on the west coast of the Earth's continents. Warm summers and cool winters are characterized here. The semi-arid deserts, they have 250 to 350 millimeter of rainfall and the temperatures are 20 to 30 degrees centigrade. More than one third of Australia is a semi-arid desert. Now, there are also subtropical deserts. They are located at latitudes near and above the Tropic of Cancer. The Great Sahara Desert of North Africa, Arabian Desert of Middle East and Tropic of Capricorn in the Australian interior and interior pampas of Argentina. The mid-latitude deserts include the Gobi Desert of Central Asia, deserts in the western interior of the United States. Now, there are some factors which are responsible for desert formation. Let us see them one by one. Earth circulation, air circulation patterns, and wind patterns are one of the important factors. Most of the deserts, if you see, they are located between the latitude 15 and 30 north and south of the equator. Here the trade winds blow offshore. Now the warm air will hold more moisture than the cold air. The warm air will rise at the equator and cool. The cool air has lesser water holding capacity, and so there will be precipitation. It falls down as rain. The dry air mass, it will move northward and southward, that is 30 degree north and south of latitude of the equator, and here this warm air will evaporate more. It will result in the evaporation of water and desert formation. So that is what this figure over here shows you, that in these regions you find the hot deserts, that is 30 degree north and south of the equator, and in the higher regions you find the cold deserts, that is it could be in the Arctic and the Antarctic regions. Rain shadow effect. This is also a very important factor in the formation of deserts. When the hot rising air approaches a mountain, it will cool. And when this cool air, it crosses this mountain and falls on the other side, then the air will evaporate, the water will go off. So there is little precipitation on the leeward side. This is also called as the rain shadow area. This example, a classic example, is the Gobi Desert, which is found on the leeward side of the desert. So this figure exactly demonstrates what I said now, that this cool, the hot rising air, it will ascend up the mountain, it will approach the mountain, it will cool, and then this will cross the mountain, and then the dry air will come down, and then here there will be more evaporation, there will be little precipitation, and this is a rain shadow area, and here the desert formation occurs. Distance from the ocean is also an important factor. When the land is far away from the ocean, then deserts form. The near cold ocean currents, the cold ocean air warms as it passes over the continents. So the warmer air will hold more moisture and causes evaporation and in the formation of deserts. There are certain fluvial processes which occur in deserts. Erosional features, that is a lack of the vegetational cover here, flash flooding, sheet wash and rilling are common. So intense rainfall effects will lead to large amounts of sediments which can be mobilized in a very short span of time. Desert hydrology, they are dominated by the ephemeral streams that can be seasonal. There are dry lake beds which are common, the playa lakes which have high evaporation rates. There are also salt flats. So the playa lakes have dissolved salts that will precipitate on the lake floor as evaporation. You can actually see them as white deposits. The pluvial lakes, which are perennial, they are found in the Great Salt Lake, the Pyramid Lake of Nevada. These are some examples. The fluvial erosional landscape features, high rates of physical weathering can change the desert landscape. You find the topographic features like the butte, mesa, inselbergs and also the pediments. Fluvial deposition in the arid landscapes, that is the debris that can be eroded and there can be deposited on the valley floors as the talus slopes or the alluvial deposits. The deposition features are that of the alluvial flans and bajada. Wind process in desert. So there can also be certain wind process which occurs in the deserts, and the wind erosion can occur here. They can break down and disperse the particles by wind movement. It occurs by three different methods, that is the abrasion, deflation and attrition. The wind abrasion, ventifax, you can see in this figure on the right hand corner of the slide. So ventifax are structures that have become smoothened because of the abrasion of the particles which have caused that smoothening. So in the desert, the wind abrasion process can also result in ridge and furrow landscapes. These are actually seen in places like Bahrain. The wind deflation, it is a erosion of soil due to removal of the sand, dust, rocks by the action of wind. Due to this, the surface of the desert becomes rocky, consisting with gravel sized particles. The wind attrition, it is a process in which the wind borne particles collide with each other and wear out in the process. Sand dunes are also characteristic of desert. We also love to go and click photographs and also enjoy walking on these sand dunes. So this is also a wind characteristic feature that occurs, the formation that occurs in the deserts. They can be uniform in size and shape. You can actually see them as carpets or seeing them in steps and in uniform distances. So they are uniform in size and their shape. They form abundant supply of sand is required and steady wind is also required. They slope gently in the upwind direction. The wind blows sand into a network of trough and crests and ripples perpendicular to the wind direction. So for this type, the quality and the quantity of the sand available is important. The direction of the wind and the nature of the desert ground is also important factors. The type of the sand dunes that can be formed, they could be crescent shaped, star shaped, parabolic or linear shaped sand dunes. Other wind deposition features include the loess, the sand sheets, deflation hollows like the Ketara depression is an example of this formation. So these are everything that have to do with wind in the desert. Now what are the life forms and adaptations that we find in the deserts? Desert plants. So they are annual, ephemeral and the perennial plants. They can be classified as drought escapers, evaders and resistors. So normally the plants that are found in the desert, they are actually able to tolerate the high extreme conditions of the weather, that is the high heat, the high temperature conditions and also the less amount of water that is available in the desert. So these plants you can find in the deserts are named as xerophytes. Cacti are drought resistors. They have spines that cool their body, that cool the plant. The cacti store a lot of moisture in the plant. That is why when you pluck the cacti, some water and liquid or gel kind of material oozes out of the stem or the leaf. So they have the spongy stems and during periods of rain, they use it and they use this gel kind of material in the dry periods and during the rain, they of course are able to store the moisture in their stems. The mesquite trees, these are also characteristic trees that are found in the deserts. They have very long taproots that can even reach 100 feet down and that can help to take them the groundwater that is present. So 100 feet means you can see how long below the ground they can go in search of water. The creosote, this is also a drought resistor. They can produce toxins so that they can prevent other plants growing nearby, near them, and other plants cannot survive in that area near these creosotes. There are annual plants which are, as the name indicates, annual. They are herbaceous. The life cycle is less than a year. Example is Panicum turgidum. Ephemeral plants, they have the short life cycle like the alyssum. These plants come after rains, they reproduce and die and then they go off after this season. The perennial plants, they survive by minimal loss of water. They are xerophytic. The leaves are leathery. They are coated with wax stomas, closed due to reduce the transpiration and the evaporation. The stomas are normally closed. The examples over here are those plants belonging to the Cactaceae and the Euphorbiaceae. So these were something about the plant life in the desert. What about the animals in the desert? So the animals also adapt to these dry conditions of the desert, high heat and less water availability. The aestivation. So in order to escape the heat, many of the animals take a small sleep, that is they escape the drought by sleeping, which is also known as the aestivation. Spadefoot toads, they are known to sleep in the underground burrows for years covered by jelly-like substances. Others like the reptiles and the snake, desert snails, they can remain in their shells as long as even 5 long years. So they are able to escape these high temperature conditions by the process of aestivation. Then some of the animals, they produce resistant eggs. They are tough eggs that can tolerate years of heat, and when the conditions are favorable, then the eggs can hatch out into new ones, for example the crustaceans or the triops. Migration. Some of the animals can migrate to different areas like the Melosopsitacus. This can travel thousands of kilometers during the extremely dry conditions and then they return back when the seasons are favorable. Nocturnal activity, that is means the nightlife is more. So the animals avoid the day activity and they survive and they are active during the night. Some of the animals, they live in the deep burrows during the daytime. Soaring, the birds soar at very high layers of the earth at the sky. So they soar high in the sky in order to avoid these the desert conditions. For example, the hawks, the vultures, the eagles, they all soar to very high heights where the temperatures are a bit cooler. Desert animals are also characterized by long legs and big ears. Why is this so? Some desert animals have the oversized ears, not to hear more, but that is actually helping them to prevent the heat and to help them cool the body more by radiating heat. the jackrabbits, desert foxes, camel and the gazelle. These are some examples. Adaptations of the camel. As we all know, camel is a ship of the desert, and we are fascinated when we go to the desert to click pictures along with the camel and along with the sand dunes that are found in the background of the deserts. So the camel, so this is a main hero of the desert, and this stores fat in the hump for their food. Okay, they have long eyelashes which are protecting the eyes from the flash flood, from the dusty storms in the deserts. They have a thick coat of fur, and this and the underwool, that is for insulation from these high temperatures. They conserve the water by excreting even their urine as the hard and dry feces. They can lose up to 25% of the body weight, and when the water comes back, then they can regain this again. They can rehydrate. They can also regurgitate the water back to the mouth. They can store the water when the water availability is there, then they store it into their body and regurgitate back when it is required. They drink up to 150 liters of water in just less than 10 minutes. So this is a lot. They survive even when the water temperature, when the body temperature goes above 12 degrees centigrade. But in human beings, even a 1 or 2 degree centigrade, when we have fever, then we are forced to take certain tablets and maybe antibiotics if there are some bacterial infections. But they can survive very high temperatures or even 12 degrees more than the normal. Anthropogenic factors. So there are certain anthropogenic factors which have caused desertification to occur in the past decade. Overgrazing, this is nothing but unsustainable agriculture and grazing. This occurs when the number of cattle, goat, herd, all this can graze an area that exceeds the carrying capacity of that particular area. The changes in vegetation occur, the soil quality is also reduced. Over cultivation, so that is here there is more food production which is required to feed large numbers of populations. Deforestation, the forests are cleared for the agricultural purposes and fuel wood. This leads to desiccation of the soil and lowered water tables. Inappropriate agricultural irrigation practices and agricultural practices, there is poor irrigation technique will result in reduced soil fertility, and this can also lead to salinization and water logging. Combating desertification is very important. So the United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification in 2006, this was an international treaty to aim to protect effective action through innovative local program and international partnerships. More than 1 billion people have little access to water, water the elixir of life, and by 2030 we will see that the demand will increase by 30%. Already we are seeing in certain parts of Africa there is actually very less and scarce amounts of water. So this can displace 700 million people by 2030. So the land degrading practices should be stopped, and people should go for sustainable practices and rain water harvesting practices. The World Day to Combat Desertification and Drought is normally observed on 17th of June. The General Assembly adopted this convention linking environment and development to sustainable land management. To make the public aware of land degradation, work for improving the conditions of for the people living in the dry land to restore their productivity and also to address the drought mitigation factor. This was the aim and the objective of celebrating or observing this 17th of June as the World Desert Day. The summary of this session. So here we have learnt about the deserts, the desertification processes. What are the different factors that lead to the desertification processes? How, what are the fluvial, the wind erosion patterns, and how they have caused certain characteristics to be formed in the deserts? We have also seen the life and adaptations that are seen in the desert, the life of plants, that the different animals that are seen, and the adaptation that they are taking place. For example, the camels, they are able to store the fat and the water, and then they regurgitate it back whenever it is required. The jackrabbits, they have the oversized ears that protect them from the heat, and it cools their body. The plants also, for example, the mesquite trees, they have the long taproot system which reach up to 100 feet below the ground, and they can go in search of water. So these are certain adaptations that the plant and the animals are also taken. And we have seen the human activities which have caused the desertification process to occur. The natural process occurring, we can do nothing about that, but the human causes, the human induced ones, definitely we have a role to play. And this is only because of overgrazing, over cultivation, the shifting agricultural practices, the forest being degraded. So all this is causing the more and more of the drylands to be created and desertification to occur. And the 11th of June is observed as the desertification or the desert day, the 17th of June, which is known as this day. And we should all come together, and public participation along with the government will play a long role, long way in combating such problems of deserts and desertification. Thank you.